Hi everyone, Omores here. Check this out, an ICD battery from 1991 that still holds a charge. Even more impressive, it didn't leak and destroy this 386 motherboard, which probably hasn't been powered on since the late 90s. So the BIOS kind of lost track of time, but it's only off by a few years. I think 2022 is close enough, right? Today, of course, it's not about batteries from 1991, it's about those games from that era and whether they can run on a modern PC, as I've been asked recently. The answer is yes, we can. More on that later. To prove my point, I've put together something special, a 386 PC crammed into an ATX case with an 80 power source, because we can actually do that. Why not? All right, let's kick things off with Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis, a game from 1992 running on this 386 SX 33 MHz PC with 4 MB of RAM, which was a typical setup for 1992. We'll let Indy entertain us for just 2 minutes to get a taste of what PC gaming was like back then. Don't worry, I'm not going to play the entire game, so no need to change the channel. Just sit back and relax.
All right, Jones, how are you gonna find that statue and all this junk? Well, here I am in New York, wondering how Sophia Hopgood got mixed up with Nazi spies. Hello there.
The show sold out, sir.
But...
no seats, no standing room, no exceptions.
If you ask me, I still find this game very entertaining. Just imagine how cool it must have been to play this back in 1992. Now back to our setup. The game ran smoothly with music and sound on a Sound Blaster 16, a top-tier product of 1992, featuring CD-quality audio sampling. This, of course, is an ISA sound card. The PCI standard was just around the corner at the time, but even so, sound cards didn't switch sides for a few more years. Now, when it comes to ISA sound cards and those games, they rely on DMA, short for Direct Memory Access. Well, with DMA, sound cards could communicate directly with the system memory, bypassing the CPU, and this took a huge load off the processor, which was especially important when you didn't have too much CPU power to spare, like on a 286 or a 386 system like this. As PC hardware evolved, ISA slots and with them traditional DMA were phased out. Early PCI motherboards still supported DMA as a legacy feature, and workarounds like DDMA allowed PCI sound cards to function like an ISA sound card in DOS. However, once this legacy support disappeared, PCI sound cards stopped working in pure DOS because they relied on hardware level access that now is no longer available on modern hardware. Some PCI sound cards, like the Aurel Vortex series, didn't rely on direct hardware access. Instead, they used a software-based approach at the driver level to intercept DMA requests. And these are like the only cards that can still work in DOS without any hardware support at the chipset level. Well, a similar approach is used in Windows, where DOS games are run inside a VDM, virtual DOS machine. This means the games don't have a direct access to the hardware, like they would in pure DOS, but they believe they do, since every hardware request from the DOS environment is actually intercepted and managed by Windows. And when it comes to those games, Windows uses a Sound Blaster emulation layer through the SBEmul sys file, which works most of the time. This compatibility layer redirects sound-related requests to the actual sound driver, but there is a catch. We need a sound driver that uses the newer Windows driver model, or WDM. Sound cards with older Windows 95 style VXD drivers won't work with the Sound Blaster emulation layer, meaning no sound in those games. However, they should still work fine in Windows. Well, the good news, for some cards there are both VXD and WDM drivers. Typically, original drivers are VXD, but the later drivers are WDM type. So now we know what to look for: WDM drivers. All right, now let's check Indiana Jones, this time running through VDM drivers using a very typical PCI sound card from 1999, which is a Sound Blaster PCI 128. By the way, we are running Windows 98 on a 13th gen CPU, but this is all news on this channel. So we start the game using the Sound Blaster settings. The game starts, the sound works, but no music.
All right, Jones, how are you going to find that statue and all this junk? I'm back!
Now, let's start the game with Roland settings, and what do we know? Now we have both music and sound, so welcome to the Sound Blaster emulation layer world.
All right, Jones, how are you going to find that statue and all this junk?
Now, besides potential sound issues, some of those games simply won't work on modern, faster CPUs. Even a Pentium 2 can cause problems, not to mention a modern Raptor-like CPU. For example, Lotus 3 from 1993 is one of those games. But since we have this 386 PC laying around, let's take a quick look at how this slow CPU-friendly game performs. Alright, let's wrap things up. So, most of those games run just fine on modern, faster hardware, and the same goes for sound, as long as we use VDM drivers in Windows, of course. While some tweaking may be needed and a few stubborn titles might not work at all, the good news is that most major games will run without issues, so I think we can sit back and enjoy them, rather than worrying about those few titles just won't work, and that's it. It is what it is. Now let's take a quick look at the DOS version of the Need for Speed from 1994, which PC Magazine called the next best thing to owning a 200k sports car. Well, I don't know. And one more thing, I know, actually I'm sure that someone's going to say, Jude, but you have a Wave Blaster hooked up to that Sound Blaster 16. And yeah, yes I do. It was and still is a pretty expensive accessory, like $300-$400 with some exaggerations like this. But don't worry, we'll cover that in a separate video. Until then, thanks for watching and supporting me. Stay tuned for the next one.